हरि ओम। वेलकम टू दिस प्रोग्राम ऑफ ट्रेडिशनल योगा। आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द होलिस्टिक नेचर ऑफ द साइंस ऑफ योग। योग इज बीइंग टॉट एंड प्रैक्टिस्ड हियर इन इंडिया फॉर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ इयर्स। इट्स मोर ऑफ अ वे ऑफ लाइफ। It includes practices that start as early as when you get up and that go late to the point that you go to sleep, and even how to sleep. So, in a way, yoga is a practice of 24 hours, and that's why it's called way of life. And that's why it is lifestyle. The popularity of yoga has grown rapidly in last 20-30 years. When the Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, he proposed in United Nations the Yoga Day, 185 plus countries supported this resolution, which in itself is a clear indication of universal acceptability of yoga. Yoga has, it's been practiced everywhere, showing its non-religious nature. It's The practices are beyond all the discriminations of sex, of religions, of socio-economic status. And people believe that yoga is good for you. It certainly increases flexibility and strength. Yoga is known to have stress relieving effect. Overall, the physical and mental health is improved by the practice of yoga. And that's why it has become very popular among old people, among women, among athletic people, among younger people. People use it for weight loss. People use it for backache, people use it for concentration. In the corporates, they use the yoga and meditation to improve the performance, increase the profitability, increase the output of the employees. There's absenteeism of the employees go down if they practice regularly yoga practice for 1 hour at least. So, popularity of yoga has exploded suddenly if you see the last 10 to 15 years. If you look at the purpose of yoga, traditionally yoga aims at spiritual development. It's a science of uniting the individual consciousness with the cosmic consciousness, Atma and Paramatma, oneness. To join your consciousness to the cosmic, or to realize the oneness. In the 20th century, although yoga was more associated, or is still more associated with healthy and strong body, to make it physically fit, to keep it slim, strong. But now in 21st century, the shift is slightly more towards lifestyle. So many researches have been done on yoga. So many different practices connected with lifestyle have been adapted, such as healthy food, such as practice of meditations, such as practice of some yamas and niyamas, some ethical and moral disciplines. So all these, they are connected with lifestyle. So this is how the yoga is changing now. Now let's move ahead and try and understand what is lifestyle of yoga. And this is what is called traditional practice of yoga, or traditional yoga, you can say it. And how does it touch the different aspects of our day-to-day life? A very important text on yoga is called Bhagavad Gita. It's about 5,000 years old yoga text. It's basically it's written in Sanskrit. And this text of Bhagavad Gita is a dialogue between two people. One is Guru. His name is Shri Krishna. He was a king, but he was also considered a yoga master. And another person is Arjun. Arjun is also a king. He is a very good friend of Shri Krishna. And Arjuna treats Shri Krishna as his guru. So this text is a dialogue between Shri Krishna and Arjun. And Arjun is facing a very serious problem in his life, and that has caused depression to him. And Shri Krishna is telling that the way out of depression is yoga. And in this discussion, Shri Krishna mentions the lifestyle. And what is this lifestyle that Shri Krishna is talking about? The verse in chapter 6 of Bhagavad Gita says, Yukta ahara viharasya yukta cheshtasya karmasu yukta swapnava bodhasya yoga bhavati dukkha. The essence of this is the controlled thoughts, emotions and actions. The way I am thinking, the subjects that I am thinking about, the thoughts that I have related to the daily routine, or related to my desires, related to my likes, my dislikes, my reactions, or the emotions that are triggered, the feelings that are triggered, the emotions become a very powerful deciding factor in our day-to-day life. It's the emotions that make our life positive or negative. So these emotions are also a very important part that needs to be controlled. And the last is the actions. The actual behavior, what I'm doing. And there is no control. We often find that the thoughts that I have, I can't control these thoughts. Since morning, I'm just thinking about this, I'm just worrying about this, and that is triggering anxiety, that is emotion in me. And then because of this disturbed thinking process, disturbed emotions, my actions are confused. I don't know what I should be doing. Once the thoughts become uncontrolled, the emotions are influenced. But we can still intervene in emotions. But if we don't control these reactions or emotions, then our actions are again confused. Again, we can control our actions, but they are mostly carrying the influence of these thoughts and emotions. The whole idea of yoga lifestyle revolves around these three powerful forces in us. The thoughts is our intellectual energy. Emotions is our feelings. And it represents willpower as well. And finally, the actions, that is our behavior. Now, how to achieve this control of thoughts, emotions, and actions? Yoga says, first, controlled and disciplined diet. Ahar is the word used. And this diet is very important in all texts of yoga, just not Bhagavad Gita, but it's there in Hatha Yoga in a big way. It's there in Ashtanga Yoga. Why diet is so important? Modern medical science has tried to understand what is the best food, what is the right diet for us. There are so many different types of diets that are recommended. If you just go to Google and check different types of diet, you will get more than 50 different types of diets. And every diet is right in its own way. There are some studies that back up. No, this Atkinson diet is very good. This high protein diet is very good. This low carb diet is the best. Mediterranean diet is the best. Someone says no, vegan diet is the best. Now there's this paleo diet that is the best. Yogic texts have discussed this diet as well. And they have given extreme importance to this diet. Why? Not only the diet is important to give energy to our body, but it is also important for giving energy to our mind. Yogic texts have equivocally talked about eating a sattvic diet. What is a sattvic diet? The diet that is light to digest, the diet that is more towards vegetarianism, a diet that is more fresh with the local ingredients and in controlled quantity, following the times of what when we eat. Yogic texts have given many more guidelines that you are going to study in the yogic diet lecture. So this is a very important subject. If I eat wrong food, like my body doesn't get some proteins, or maybe doesn't get enough vitamins, or doesn't get proper minerals, my mind is also not getting the right energy to think properly. If you eat very heavy food and late in the night, you may notice that next day morning you feel more lazy in the mind as well. You don't think very clearly. You just don't want to think, you just want to sleep. So diet has very interesting effect on your thinking process. Emotions also. If you eat very spicy diet, it can make you bit more irritable as far as emotions are concerned. So yogic texts have considered the diet as a very important aspect of my day-to-day life, which I need to control and have more discipline. Then the next aspect is the other sensory organs. The diet is about tongue. Often we let the tongue uncontrolled, then we are going to face problems. In today's world, 60% people in developed countries or even in India are obese. The body mass index, BMI, is about 2.4-2.5, which is a serious problem. But why it's happening? Because I'm eating too much. Why am I eating too much? Because I'm eating for the tongue. Oh, it tastes so good. Let me eat more. Oh, if I eat more, I'm going to put on weight. I know that. But what is the excuse I give? Say, yeah, tomorrow I'll walk more. But that tomorrow never happens. I never get up on time and go for a walk. The resolve is there in the night to get up. But in the morning, the resolve wins, goes away. This is about tongue, but the same thing is about every other sensory organ. I am continuously, my eyes, wanting to see more beautiful things. Oh, this phone looks so beautiful. I want this phone. Oh, this car looks so beautiful. I want this car. Oh, this new dress is so pretty. I want it. My eyes are getting attracted to that. And these sensory organs, for example, eyes or ears, they pull us towards these objects. And that disturbs our thinking and emotions. If I'm continuously running behind this object, for example, phone, then I will be distracted. When I want to purchase a new phone, how much research I do? I go on internet, check all these websites, ask my so many friends, check that phone technical details, specifications everywhere. So my thinking process is disturbed because my thoughts are continuously focused on that. When I think of coffee, what happens? I keep thinking about it again and again. So my mind gets distracted. And that distracted state of mind, I lose the balance of emotions and thoughts. And that results in disturbed actions and behavior. Every object of sensory organ, connected with sensory organ, can distract us. So we need to have control and discipline. Then the next is our daily routine. Controlled, disciplined daily routine. This is a very, very important part. What time I should get up? What time I should take my shower? What time I should eat? What time I should do my exercise? What time I should rest? What time I should not do any physical or mental work but just relax? This is all very important. In my life, my daily routine is not very disciplined. Sometimes I wake up, I go to bed late. Sometimes I wake up late. Sometimes I eat late. Sometimes I skip my exercise. Look, all of these lifestyle related, routine related behaviors are known to have negative effect on our health. Not doing exercise at the right time is a big problem. Let me tell you, share a very interesting hormone cycle in our body. There's a hormone in our body called cortisol. People know it as a stress hormone, but it's a very important hormone that brings us energy. So cortisol is not only a stress hormone, it has a role of giving you energy. When you get up early in the morning and when you have good energy and you say, yes, I'm fresh, let's go for a run, that is also cortisol. So now, when you get up in the morning, at around 7 o'clock, the cortisol is quite high. And that's why you want to do some exercise, you want to go for a walk, or you want to go and swim, or you want to go and do some yoga practice. It's this high cortisol. Now, after 9 o'clock in the morning, the cortisol starts dropping down slowly, slowly. After 12 in the noon, the cortisol drops further. That's why in the afternoon, most of us feel very sleepy or lazy kind of, because the cortisol is dropped. In the afternoon, after 4 o'clock in the evening, there is a small peak of cortisol again, say 4 to 6. And after sunrise, at the sunset, the cortisol drops completely. And it reaches its lowest value in the midnight, like 12 o'clock in the midnight. Now, if our physical behavior is adjusted to this natural cycle of cortisol, it will be much better. So it's much better to exercise either in the morning when the cortisol is high, or in the evening when the cortisol has a second smaller peak. But you can't practice exercise in the night, or you can't practice exercise, or you can't just do some very strong physical activity after 12 in the noon, then it is going to disturb your cortisol cycle. So even the medical science, I just gave you the example for exercising with cortisol and physical activities. But look at your food habits, what time you're eating. If one day I don't eat By 12 noon, then I may suffer from acidity or indigestion, because that digestive system also has a cycle, has a routine. The exercise also needs to be done as per the routine, like the natural cycle of my body. If I disturb this, if there is no discipline in my daily routine, my physical and mental health is going to be affected in a big way. So this is a very important aspect, controlled daily routine. And then sleep. If you take example of sleep, yoga gives so much of importance to the sleep and relaxation. In fact, I will tell you that whatever has happened in the day today, for example, oh, I worked hard in the morning, maybe mentally I worked hard, maybe physically I worked hard, or maybe I was emotionally a little bit not positive, I was a bit angry, whatever has happened, my body has spent energy, my mind has spent energy. The sleep is there for a reason. And what is the reason? Whatever has happened in the day with physical, mental, emotional activities, or thinking activities also, your brain also consumes a lot of energy. Every thought consumes a lot of energy. There's a lot of studies like that. So whether your activity is thinking or feeling or actions, is going to consume the energy. Now all of that energy, sleep is going to re-energize. Sleep is going to bring back that energy that I lost, so that tomorrow morning I am exactly like how I was today morning. And this is so important, because if my sleep by any chance is little less, or it's not very relaxed, or it's not very deep, then I am not going to recover all of the energy that I spent yesterday. So tomorrow morning, that is today, because last night's sleep was not good, today I have less energy than what I had yesterday. And this is how the problems start. So sleep is extremely important in yoga. The yoga techniques, they make the sleep more deep. But again, sleep is important. Yoga text also say too less a sleep is bad, too much sleep is also bad. If you sleep someday very late, like very long, then you may experience laziness during the whole day. You may feel better because you had a good sleep, but you still feel lazy because there is something that is not balanced. So yoga has given a lot of importance to discipline. Not too much on this side, not too much on that side. But whatever is there is extremely important. If I can control my thoughts, if I can control and discipline my thinking process, if I'm not thinking too much about coffee all the time, then probably my sensory organs, I can control them. Probably I can control my coffee intake. If the thoughts become very stressful, or the emotions are very stressful, then my sensory organs also become indisciplined. Generally, if you are stressed, then you eat unhealthy food. That's also what studies have said. And if these sensory organs are indisciplined, then they are just going to disturb my daily routine. My eyes say, oh, let's watch this movie tonight. But I'm sleepy. I need to go to bed by, say, 10, 10:30, 11, 11:30. Maximum 11:30. But no, I'm not going to sleep, because my sensory organs say, no, no, this movie is nice. My daily routine is disturbed. Oh, I want to go out in the restaurant where the food is very delicious there, sensory organs. And it disturbs my daily routine because I go there very late. And I overeat, loss of discipline of diet. So these are all interconnected ideas. So everything that I do from the moment I get up in the morning to the moment I go to sleep has to be disciplined and controlled. And that is yoga lifestyle. The whole purpose of this yoga lifestyle is to get rid of the negativity that we experience in our life. The negativity can be in any form, maybe physical disorders, physical health issues, or mental disorders, mental health issues. Through this discipline, we can control and discipline all our actions, all our karmas. And this is the traditional yoga goal of our yoga practice. Now, to achieve this lifestyle, there are different disciplines of yoga, which you can call as different types of yoga. And this is all together a traditional yoga. The first part of this traditional yoga is Ashtanga Yoga. This is a yoga taught by Patanjali about 2500 years ago. He wrote a small text called Yoga Sutras. It is only 196 or 197 lines. Sanskrit text, very small lines, 3 to 4 to 5 words, one line. Like this 197 lines. And in that, he discussed the entire discipline of Ashtanga Yoga. Eightfold Yoga starts with Yamas. More of social discipline, non-violence, truth, celibacy, non-possessiveness. These are Yamas. And then Niyamas. The purity, the austerities, the contentment. These are all self-discipline ideas. Then the third step in Ashtanga Yoga is asanas, yoga poses, which is the most popular practice of yoga all over the world. Then comes fourth step, that is pranayama, the breathing. Then the next step is pratyahara, dharana and dhyana, next three steps. And these three steps are about meditation. And the last stage is called samadhi, which is actually the state of nirvana, as Buddha discussed it. The state of complete dissolution of the gross mind, or one can say enlightenment, or the self-realization dimension. Or you can say the dimension of our own mind, which is free of all the sufferings, as Buddha discussed it. Patanjali was contemporary to Buddha. So you can see so many similarities of Ashtanga Yoga with Buddhism. But predominantly, because you're focusing on the mind, even when you're talking about non-violence and non-stealing and celibacy and truth, these are connected with mind. Even the practice of asanas is done to control the mind. The pranayama, the meditations, all of these techniques are especially for control of mind. So Ashtanga Yoga is considered more as discipline of your mind. Then there is another important path, that is Hatha Yoga. Now, why the word Hatha Yoga is important for us? Because Hatha Yoga has focused so much more on asanas, yoga poses, and on breathing. Of course, there is meditation in Hatha Yoga. Of course, there is Yamas and Niyamas in Hatha Yoga, like Ashtanga Yoga. But still, the focus of Hatha Yoga remains the asanas, pranayama, cleansing techniques. And that is why Hatha Yoga is considered as a discipline of body and prana. The prana is a vital energy. We are going to discuss this idea of prana in lectures on Hatha Yoga. Then there are next three types of yogas, which does not involve yoga poses or breathing practices directly. But Bhakti Yoga, for example, focuses on discipline of emotions. The emotions play a very important role. The reactions that I give decide my state of my mind, my mood. That decides how my body is going to be. If I am angry, my body is also disturbed. If I am sad, my body is also sad, my mind is also devoid of energy, I have no energy in the mind and body. Because emotions play a very critical role, this Bhakti Yoga path talks about how to discipline and control these emotions. And through this emotional control, you can control your body, you can control your breath, and you can control your mind. Another path is Karma Yoga, path of Karma Yoga. My thoughts and my emotions lead to certain actions. When these emotions and thoughts are uncontrolled, my actions are also uncontrolled. But if I start controlling my actions, I can also slowly go back and control my emotions and discipline my thinking process as well. That is, I can discipline my mind, I can discipline my body through discipline of my actions. Sometimes people who just control their reactions in a very positive way, we find that they are very healthy and they are very happy people. That is the idea of Bhakti Yoga. You may find people in your life who have very disciplined routines, who have very disciplined actions and behavior. They put so much of discipline onto how they react, how they walk, how they get up, how they eat. And all this brings again good physical and mental health to them. That is a path of Karma Yoga. And then the Jnana Yoga is a discipline of intellect. Of course, this is the thinking process again involved here. But when one can discipline the intellect to bring changes to our emotions and actions. So intellect or thinking can also be a very positive force which is used in Jnana Yoga. For example, many of us understand that yes, this particular behavior is not good for me. For example, someone decides that I'm not going to eat sweets. Now this is an intellect thinking, because it's not that it's not good and it gives a lot of bad effects on the physical health. So I bring discipline to my thinking process. I am going to stop this eating this sugar, for example. And then with that continuous thinking and discipline to your thinking, you can get rid of sugar, that is your action. You can get rid of that craving, that is your emotions. So all these five important types, Ashtanga Yoga, Hatha Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga together is a traditional yoga or lifestyle. There are certain other types of yoga which come from another branch of the science of yoga, that is called Tantra. And these branches such as Kundalini Yoga or Kriya Yoga or Nada Yoga, Laya Yoga, they are also involving meditative practices or practices related to breathing, or some advanced practices of mudras and bandhas. And these practices directly control our pranic energy. And why to control this energy? Because this is the energy that controls our physical body and our mind. So this is what you're going to learn in this 1 month yoga teacher training program, the traditional yoga idea. We are going to discuss a lot more on Ashtanga Yoga, Hatha Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, also Kundalini Yoga. So I'm going to stop here. Hari Om.